Hi, I'm Mamita, and today I'm going to take you on a roller coaster ride of how healing your present self, be it healing your limiting beliefs, healing your traumas, or your negative emotions, or doing any kind of therapy, not only heals your present self, but also heals your past parallel versions of you who still exist and are connected to you. And it also changes your future timeline, your future path, your destiny. In other words, it also affects your future versions of you. Or in other words, how you are acting like your past version of yourself's spirit guides. So this is a tremendous revelation I experienced when I was doing my level 2 training in holographic memory resolution. And I'm so excited to share this entire journey. So I'm going to break it down into a little bit about trauma and how it is encoded in the body, which is also I realized while I was doing this training. It's not shared by the founder, who is Brent Baum, but it is a realization I had when I was experiencing this course and all the materials in it. And this is a question I always had as to what, like, how is trauma encoded in the body? Like, how is it stored in the body? I always had this question and I knew it. It's just not at the energetic level. It has to be on the physical level also in some way. And I finally found the answer to that. So first, I'm going to cover what and how the body encodes the trauma. And second, I'm going to describe a little bit about parts fragmentation and how that is connected to your past parallel selves. And yeah, that is going to be the entire structure. So stay with me. Let me share my screen. So yeah. Let me talk a little bit about how our body is structured. Now, this is something you may or may not have discovered yet, but I would highly recommend checking out works of Bessel van der Kolk on Body Keeps a Score, or Brent Baum's work on holographic memory resolution. Or there are at least 13 scientists like Bruce Lipton, Candice Pert, who talks about how the body can encode the trauma and store it. So this is my own hypothesis that I have pieced together from my 3 years of research on this topic. So this is how it works. Each organ, as well as our entire muscle, the entire body has a distribution of neurons, which I call the constellations of consciousness. Neurons usually are cells who are specialized to transmit messages which are more conscious in nature, unlike other cells in the body, which may also may have certain degree of consciousness, but it doesn't work the way neurons are specialized to do. So you could say neurons are what makes an organ conscious. So each organ and different parts of the body has its own distribution of a neural network. The entire body is connected with the brain, and the communication between each organ and each part of the body is happening through these neurons. So all the decision making and the trauma encoding that happens doesn't just happen in the brain. In science, the brain gets an undue recognition in processing cognitive behaviors, but majority of the unconscious mind and cognitive processing doesn't just happen in the brain, it also happens in the body. Or in other words, the body has its own consciousness. This is a concept I first encountered in the book Conversations with God by Neil Donald Walsh, and I was surprised. But then I continue, but the, I already had some idea about this because of all the works of different authors that I have read, like Metaphysical Anatomy by Evett Rose and Louise Hay's Heal Your Body. So I don't remember the other scientist's work, which I had researched on right now. I'm not able to recall. Oh, yeah, there's Carl Dawson, matrix re-imprinting with EFT. So you can do your research and you can find there are many researches on this. So as you can see, in order to understand how the body encodes the trauma, you have to understand how the body stores information. So the brain has 100 billion neurons and it is specialized for cognitive processing. However, this is not the only organ that has consciousness or cognitive processing. The gut has 500 million neurons, the heart has 40,000 neurons, kidney has 40,000 neurons, lungs have 100 million neurons, skin has 8 million, and there are, I'm not, I didn't go into details of the other organs because I think this alone illustrates the point I'm trying to make, that each organ have their own consciousness and can store information just like the brain does and can also process it. In other words, each part of the body has its own mind. And according to the HeartMath Institute's research, heart has a magnetic field that is 100 times more powerful than the brain's. And its field can be felt by 4 feet away from the body. And they have very interesting research facts around the heart's function in the body and how heart has its own mind. They have done phenomenal work. So now that you understand that this is how information can get stored in the body, not just the brain, let me show you what happens when you're traumatized. So there are different neural networks distributed all throughout the body. So as you can see in this image, you could consider these lines that you see as neural networks. Now, these yellow dots that you see, these are specific nodes, you could say. Nodes, as in these are the points where highest clusters of neuron happen, or this is where majority of the consciousness activity is happening. Now, this is not specific to the body location. This is just an example. As most of you who have studied biology or neural network would know that neurons that fire together, operate together, are also connected with each other. That is what they mean by neurons that fire together, wire together. Now, what does it indicate? When you are traumatized, there are specific zones in the body where the neurons, which are connected to each other, no matter what the distance is, are triggered at the same time and store the trauma. So in this image, these yellow dots that you see are the points which, say, for example, one specific traumatic event happened, and these are the neurons which were wired together, got traumatized at the same time. So the trauma is not just encoded in one spot. The trauma is now encoded in multiple spots, all these yellow points. So if I can take this out, oh, looks like I cannot. Yeah, I think I have this image. Yeah. So if I can take this circuit out here, it looks like this. This entire circuit is a bunch of neuron that is now traumatized. So when anybody who has worked with matrix re-imprinting or holographic memory resolution, these kinds of trauma methods, you will often hear that once you are healing the emotional pain in one area, the pain will move to a different part of the body. So this is what they mean. Like, say, for example, if you're hearing the traumatic encoding in this part, which corresponds to this part of the body, then the pain will move to the next part where the trauma is encoded, and then here, and then here, and then here. When you are healing, you have to heal the entire circuit. You cannot just heal just one part and expect the rest of the circuit to heal on itself. So that is why, in these two modalities of healing, we work on individual memories one by one to heal the entire nervous system that was connected to this trauma to heal it completely. Now, there is another aspect to it. So we are fundamentally not a single block of consciousness. We have, what's the right word? Like, we are adaptable based on the circumstances. Say, for example, if you are in a specific circumstance which requires you to act fast, there will be certain aspects of you that will get activated and which is adapted to this kind of situation. Whereas if you are in a social situation where you are supposed to act in more harmoniously or more friendly way, then there is another aspect of you which is adapted to handling social situation and expectations and behaviors in that. So you are not like this one block of personality which behaves the same way in every situation. And this happens because you have parts. Now, unlike other scientists who talk about that parts are created only when people are traumatized, I have a different opinion in that. My hypothesis is that people can create parts by themselves when they are trying to adapt to a situation, and it need not be caused by trauma. People may have different aspects to their personality without being traumatized, because that is the way humans adapt and bring out different strengths during different times of their life. And in this way, they get to experience the full depth and breadth of whoever or whatever qualities or talents they have. Like, you will not be using, say, for example, your crisis fighting situation in a home environment where everything is peaceful, right? So that home environment will not bring out that aspect of you. Only a crisis will bring out that aspect of you. And you wouldn't even know that you had that aspect unless you are faced with that situation. So parts are adapted to get activated in certain situations. They are like different parts of you. Like, they have their own personality, identity, thinking process, preferences, but they all those parts are nothing but different personalities of you, you could say, which with different likes, dislikes, and preferences and priorities. So, this is again, the formation of part may not be related to trauma. This is my hypothesis. This is not what most people that I know in the field of trauma healing would say. But now let's get to the part where a part is created to explain you how parts are created based on the conventional theory that is explained by different people. So when you are traumatized, as you can see, this entire node, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, these node of 6 points which are traumatized complete and create a circuit. Now, this com spe specific combination and neural pathway itself, when it is encoded with trauma, can create a separate existence of consciousness, which is different from the rest of your body. This fragmentation of this portion of the neural network from the rest of the network is called parts fragmentation. It usually happens as a body's protective mechanism. The body doesn't want, the primary objective of the body is survival. So it will not want to overwhelm the entire system, their entire body, with like a negative emotion. So what it does is it contains the trauma to only specific nodes which can handle it. In our case, the trauma is encoded in only these yellow spots and not the rest of the neural network. So it's like a containment. It's like containing in a it's like a firefighting situation where the body is trying to contain the trauma only to a specific network, so the rest is safe. So this is how the parts are created, which is a specific configuration of neural network, which has this traumatic encoding, the memory of the trauma which created it. And it is stuck in that trauma, meaning it has not released it. And its priorities are now changed and different from what it would have been had it been not traumatized. And the rest of the body does not or may not know that this is the part that is traumatized and why it is operating with different values and thoughts than the rest of the body. So, as I said, since the body can store the trauma encoding in different kinds of permutation and combination in the body, there can be many, many parts like this, which will have a different configuration. Of course, this is just for example. And all these encodings are stored in the body as nodes. So when you are doing any kind of memory-based trauma healing, like regression therapy, holographic memory resolution, matrix re-imprinting with EFT, or rapid, what was that about? Is a full form RPT, I think. I forgot the full form. There are many memory-based technique where you, even NLP methods of the NLP timeline. So there you are going back to the situation or the event that created the trauma to reframe and release a negative charge from that event so that you can finally free this system from these traumatic encodings. This is how those modalities of healing work. So now that you understand how parts are created, fragmented parts, traumatized parts are created, and how trauma is encoded in the body, I want you to take you, okay, this is an example. So this is, say, for example, an example of how many traumatic encodings can happen. Say, for example, this red line is one traumatic encoding, which is created by one set of neural wirings. This yellow is another. This is how far it extends. This purple white is another neural circuit that is traumatized, and there are these many nodes of trauma. This green one is another. So this is just a representation of how trauma can be stored at nodal point of different neural networks in the body. And these are the many parts that you may have. This is just an example. Say this person, if I have to look at this, they have one, this yellow line will now have its own personality and consciousness because this is a separate neural wiring, a structure separate from the rest of the body, which is encoded with a specific trauma. This will become one part which has its own personality and consciousness. This red one will have another. This white one will have another. So there are like four or five parts fragmentation for this person. So now this person is not having a single layer of personality. They will have different parts that respond differently in different situations because of traumatic and fragmentation. Now coming to parallel reality. So as per Brent Baum, who's the founder of holographic memory resolution, he says, and he of course borrows it from Milton Erickson, who's the father of hypnosis, and David Cheek, his protege, that trauma is a moment of self-hypnosis of the limbic, hypothalamic, pituitary, adrenal axis. So in the moment of trauma, a person, not, sorry, no, no. Sorry, I lost my train of thought. Yeah. So when a person is traumatized, they enter into a moment of self-hypnosis so that they don't have to experience the full impact of the trauma. And what happens is this zoning out, this moment of self-hypnosis, this behavior is saved in your body. Now, if you have multiple trauma, which like 100% of the population does, but they don't know or are aware of, you will experience this zoning out multiple times throughout the day because these are memories still held by the body. That's why you will notice that whenever you're reading something, listening to something or someone, or doing some activity, you will not be able to completely focus on that for extended periods of time without any interruption. You will be getting interrupted with a different thought, or forgetting, or daydreaming, or mind running off, or remembering something else. Like, it will never be a state of complete present in the moment unless you are doing meditation. Even then, people experience problem meditating. That happens because of this traumatic encoding, which is a self-hypnosis moment. Now, a person, according to Brett Baum, can enter into this moment of zoning out, dissociation, or constantly getting distracted. It could be even for a second, it doesn't matter. Even secondary, like even moments of distractions are also presence of trauma. So people can get distracted 15 to 50 times in an hour, according to his research. Now, coming to how the traumatized versions of you are still connected to your real you. Now, you need to understand that, say, if you experience one trauma, this part, this yellow dot and the white line that you see in this girl, say a person received a trauma at the age 5 and this part of fragmentation was formed. And when this traumatic fragmentation happens, these parts do not go away after the event is over. They still are connected and stay in the body because this specific neural network hasn't released the trauma, so it's still encoded. Now, at age 8, this version of this person is a different parallel version of this person. And this person, say for example, got traumatized at age 8, which created a new neural network, a different fragmentation of part. Now this person is carrying the old one as well as the new one. And every time you are fragmented, basically you are connected to that part of you. So if the fragmentation happened at this point, then going forward, no matter how much you age, you'll still be connected to this fragmented part, this parallel version of you, unless you heal the trauma. So it's like, I'll go to the next screen to explain how the parallel reality works. Or maybe I'll just explain that first because this may not make sense. So for those who are not familiar with the concept of parallel reality, you are moving through physical static frames, billions of times a second. So each static physical frame is a parallel version of you. So if you look at this image, like you think that this experience that you have of reality is smooth, where say for example my hand is moving smoothly, like, but actually this is not the way it works. It works like the early frame by frame animation that you may have experienced when you were younger. Like if you ever research frame by frame animation, early day movie animations used to be, you know, they used to draw out an entire photograph and then they used to draw another photograph with side changes from the first one and then another and then another, and they used to flip through the images so fast that it created an impression of smooth animation. So that is exactly how we are experiencing the animation of life. So we are also like physical 3D photographs, and there are billions of them, and we are, our consciousness is moving through billions of those static physical 3D photographs, billions of times a second, creating the impression of the smooth animation that you call reality around you. So each one of those static physical frames is called a parallel version of you. So going back to this concept, say for example, in this image, this is one parallel version of you. Say this is a movement, when you are moving, basically you're moving through different parallel versions, parallel reality frames of you. This is the second version. So your consciousness moved from this to this, then this to this, then this to this, then this to this, creating an impression of smooth movement. But basically, your consciousness is moving through frame by frame animation. And because it's happening very fast, it gives an impression of like there is no lag, there is no gap. But each one of these are parallel reality frames. Now, coming back to the concept of how the traumas that I was talking about. Every time you are traumatized, that is a static parallel version, a parallel reality version of you that still exists in the past timeline, but you are still connected to it because of this fragmentation. So you are like energetically connected to it. This 5-year-old part is still existing very much in this adult woman that you see in the image, but they are not consciously aware of it. So every time this person has been traumatized at these different ages, they are basically connected to all these past parallel versions simultaneously, all at the same time. So in that sense, you could say a fragmented part is a parallel reality version of you stuck in the trauma. I hope I'm able to explain this concept clearly and not confusing you too much. If you have been following my other channeling videos, I don't remember if I did specifically on parallel realities. But yeah, maybe I'll do a separate videos on that. So every time a new neural encoding of trauma is created, that stores and connects the parallel version of you that was traumatized. And so even if you grow as an adult, you're still connected to these specific ages, these specific parallel versions, which were still stuck in trauma. So when you're doing trauma healing, what you are doing is, oh wait, before we go there, so right now, even when we operate as adults, we are basically channeling our past parallel versions whenever a situation arises. So as I said, like, you're not a solid block of consciousness. You don't have a fixed, definite personality. You can adapt to different situations, or in other words, in different situations, different parts of you get activated, all the parts that may or may not have been caused by trauma. So why do I call you a channeling your past parallel versions? Because those parts were formed in the past and you're still connected to them. And when they are activated in specific situation, then basically you are going into that self-hypnosis mode, which was created in the original traumatic encoding. As I said, trauma is a moment of self-hypnosis. You are basically entering into that trance state, a self-hypnosis mode, when that part is activated and you're channeling that traumatized part of you. And it's acting the way it wants to act based on the learnings it learned during the traumatic encoding. So a person who was never afraid of fire, if they have been burned, now they are traumatized with fire. Now they're like, no, fire is danger. So if you are experiencing where you have to go, say, light some fireworks, that part will get activated. Its original trauma will get activated. No, 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 I don't want to do it. Now it will not be fearless of fire because it has a traumatic memory of fire. So it's going to avoid fire. So that part of you contains that trauma, that memory, and it gets activated. Or in other words, you are channeling that past parallel version of you in during those situations, which activates it. So when you are doing trauma healing, what you are doing is you are going back. Even if you are at this stage, if you are trying to heal, say, this yellow line of trauma, then what you're doing is basically you're connecting to this 5-year-old version when the trauma was first created, and that parallel version, which is stuck in that trauma, you're healing that part. So by healing this memory, you're not only healing this neural network, but you are also healing this 5-year-old you. And by healing the past, you are also healing the present. So it's like two-way action. You don't even have to understand the mechanics of how it is done or how it is happening. Just know that healing your present, whatever you're healing, also heals the past versions of you that have been traumatized. So every time you're healing, whichever part that you're healing, at whichever age it was traumatized, basically you are being the spirit guide for these parts. So what these child versions are, these, now another aspect of parallel reality is these parallel versions are still existing simultaneously because there is no concept of space-time. We cannot see what we are not the frequency of. They still exist here and now, but you cannot experience them because you're separated from them by a frequency. You cannot see your physical child self because you are not of the same vibration. There are many movies actually, like Predestination, where you can go and see your past self physically, but we haven't explored that technology yet where we can time travel, but that is possible and that is real. So in What was I saying? What was the point I was trying to say? So yeah, you are basically being your spirit guide of this younger version. You are coming and telling them, hey, I'm going to heal you. Just like your spirit guides are from the future who come and heal you because you are their past version. So healing you also heals them. This is one of the concept of how spirit guides and why spirit guides help you, because they are future versions of you. So in by healing you, they are also experiencing healing themselves. And when you heal your present version, then this, sorry, when you are healing the present version, you're not only healing the past parallel versions of you, you are also changing your timeline. You're also changing your future. Like if you were still traumatized, the kind of decisions you would be taking or making will not be the same when you are healed. Whatever extent it is, even if you're not fully healed, the kind of quality of actions, thoughts, behaviors you're going to do when you're not healed at all versus you have healed a little bit is going to be very different. And because your thoughts, behavior, actions are going to be different from the past version that you would have if you had not healed, your future also changes. So now your future versions will not have the experience of the trauma that your present version had experienced because you are healing them. So, in other words, you are changing your destiny. You're changing your timeline. You're moving to a new timeline now without even realizing you're doing that. So, that is why healing yourself is so critical because you are healing your entire timeline, the past and the future and the present. Isn't that amazing? So, again, going back to the screen. Ideally, the human mind is supposed to experience the present moment most of the time. Now, we have four states of consciousness. The beta state, which is when we are thinking, analyzing, doing some activity, that is the beta brainwave. Then there is alpha brainwave, where that is the moment where we are either just woken up from sleep or we are very deeply relaxed. The theta is a meditative state. And the delta brainwaves are when we are sleeping. So throughout the day, we are meant to experience all these states, but the one that we were meant to experience like more often than the beta is the alpha or the theta state. Being in the present moment is who we are. That allows us to be in a state of bliss. Those who have done the meditation for connecting with being present in the moment meditation will know what I'm talking about. You will experience so much bliss, so much aliveness, awareness about what is happening. I think in Hawaiian language it is called the hakalau state, which is a very relaxed and aware state, but being in the present moment. This is what we were supposed to be most of the time. But we are not able to be in the present moment because we are spontaneously going back to our trauma and dissociating and zoning out and getting distracted because we have that many fragmentations. So if you healed, say theoretically you healed all your trauma, then you will experience present moment more often than you do now. And that is the state we were meant to be. It's not like we will not experience beta because beta is required for analysis and thinking. We also need to experience the benefits of beta. But beta state is not something we were always meant to experience throughout the day, which is where most people are at. Most people have the beta brainwave throughout the day, which is what stresses them out. We were not supposed to be in the beta all the time. And that happens because of these not being able to be in the present moment, which again is caused by past traumas. So, I hope I have been able to explain how this trauma healing heals your past, present, and the future, and give you some idea about the encoding and everything. So, feel free to comment your questions if something is not clear, and I would love to go through and see if I can respond to those comments.